Well, it's a tough choice, but I'm going to fly the GB.
Mankind has long been fascinated with flight and speed.
Leading the start of the race will be Chapperfield's own Clip Secord.
Combinations of the two are the stuff of legend.
I'm sitting on top of the world. I'm rolling along, yes, rolling along. And I'm quitting.
A generation ago, the world stood in awe of one small race plane, and it still does.
Glory, hallelujah, just hold a hard sun. Hey, Tom, get ready to call. Just like Humpty Dumpty, I'm going up off.
In the golden age of air racing, one airplane flew faster than any other. It was called the GB, named for the Granville brothers who built it in Springfield, Massachusetts.
I'm getting my share. I've only got one suit, just one. That's all I can wear.
The GB Super Sportsters captured the hearts of the nation and its fears. Four were built. Four crashed. Now, a replica of the most famous GB cuts the clouds. This is the story of the GBR2. One of the most notorious airplanes in history flies again. In the next hour, we take an incredible ride on a pair of the fastest wings that ever flew. From a windblown field in Massachusetts, where an air racing legend was born, we journey to a similar field in Oregon, where the legend is born again. In between is a story of human triumph and tragedy, of man and machine, of dreams and goals. The story of the GB. A crisp December morning, 1991.
The airplane's coming.
A shiny new airplane rolls out before a waiting crowd in Creswell, Oregon.
Doesn't it look neat, Delmar?
Oh, it does.
None of these people has ever seen a GB fly before, but they've all heard the story. This is a replica of the airplane many call the Killer Bee.
Pretty massive, huh?
The Widowmaker.
And it's supposed to fly.
The flying coffin.
I don't think anybody's gonna believe this airplane, do you?
The GB legend and fate are about to be tested by a 40-year-old pilot from Shelby, Montana, Delmar Benjamin.
I'm ready. Let's just do it.
I guess I'm not a spectator type person. I need to get in and mix it up, get involved. It seems there's not very many people that are, everybody's sitting in front of their TV watching a small percentage of the population do something, and I get bored easily watching TV or watching other people's lives. I need to keep my own moving.
This is also a test for the man who built the GBR2 replica, 44-year-old Steve Wolf.
Yeah, we're getting pretty excited.
We built the airplane just as close to the original aerodynamically as possible, you know, and that's usually what we find when people find out, you know, that we built this airplane and flying it. There's been a lot of stories going around. Well, you know, they've had to change something to make it fly better. And we really haven't.
Hey, Delmar, I was going to write you down some frequencies, but it won't do any good, will it?
Don't need those.
Not when you don't have a radio. Like Delmar said, Doolittle didn't have a radio.
Now, if I have trouble getting it in here, which I don't foresee.
I don't either.
But then I'll follow you to Eugene.
Okay.
And you can do the radios.
Yep, I'll do the radios.
And you can just give me a thumbs up when you got me lined up on the runway.
Okay. You won't be declaring an emergency, you're just going in there. You want to give me some signal in case you're declaring an emergency for over there? What would you want to do then?
I'll know, huh?
You'll know.
I'll know.
If you see flames, and I'm going to declare
it. Then we'll declare it for you.
Liz and I went shopping last night. And I got to where I was just leaning on the shopping cart. And I said, now I know why old people have walkers, you know. I was dragging around here. And Liz says, you, and I says, well, you know, I got adding it up. In the last 44 hours, I've had 3 hours of sleep. And I says, no wonder I don't feel like going shopping. We haven't done any Christmas shopping. What is it, the day after tomorrow or something?
Let's face it, yeah. 23rd of December.
Actually, I kind of feel this is kind of a neat Christmas present.
Is this it?
This is it.
You're gonna do great. There we are.
He's got that grin now. Well, yeah. Have fun, lucky dog.
Have fun, Dal, and be careful. I envy you. I'll tell you.
What was that?
If I was careful, I would have never built a GB.
Pull forward and wrap that tailwheel around like we did.
You're gonna do just great. I'm thinking that, okay?
That's good.
Have fun.
That'll take it. Cheers. Okay, you got it.
Here you go.
Yeah, on run up, I just warm it up, get it up to operating where it just comes in the green. Then do a, you probably will, but as much power run up as you want. I'm telling. Yeah. But watch that the tail doesn't come up. I don't think it will.
Yeah, I'm gonna be ready on takeoff to push or pull.
Yeah. Just go like hell.
No one has heard a GBR2 thunder to life since 1932.
Okay, switch off.
Switch off.
Until today.
Throttle closed and crack just a little.
Okay.
Mixture rich. Go ahead and turn the boost pump on. Okay. Primer. Okay. Want to try her hot?
Okay, hot and brakes.
No one is alive to say how this airplane will behave in the air. Benjamin will use his own senses to tell him that, and rely on 20 years of flying experience to help him respond to the controls. Grainy image in old newsreels. The airborne R2 is captured for the first time in color.
Listen, listen at that whistle. He's got the do little whistle going there. Whoa! I was wondering if I was ever really going to see a GB in my lifetime, and now I have. Look at that. You can't go over a 30-degree bank. Remember what Bob Norris says, that sucker will just go in on you, you know? He doesn't look like he's terrified, does he?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
There he's joining up. If he can get it to slow down. Look at that, he's tucked right in on him.
Oh, I wonder what that sounds like.
I know. But can you imagine what they're seeing?
Benjamin proves the airplane can fly.
He's a happy boy with it, isn't he?
Hell of an airplane.
Next, he tests the GB's handling characteristics by flying inverted, his first time up.
He's inverted.
Remember you and I standing over by the paint room the other night talking this?
Yeah.
We knew this was going to happen, didn't we?
He said he's going to fly final at 140, so, you know, it's going to look like it's moving.
Get the nice smooth flare down. Right, good, good, it's leveled off. He's got her. He's got her.
That's going to be rough.
There. He's doing it. He's going to do it. He's been there before. Get off the power.
Good! Look at those exhaust stains down the side now. He's got them.
How does it feel? Does it just fly great?
It's really sensitive. You got to fly it like with fingertips. And
does it
barely,
when rolling it, does it feel good?
No, it's really good.
Everyone says, I just gotta do it. Oh, God, that was so great. When you're taking off, it's just like,
That proves the old saying, GB with a good pilot's a good airplane.
Right.
And with a bad pilot, it's a bad airplane. I mean, there's a lot of pilots that shouldn't get in that and go fly it. Yay!
I forgot to put my earplugs in.
I can't believe it.
Oh, I'm so proud of you.
Pioneers in aviation are alive and well. And thanks to them, a stubby little race plane called the GB is too.
Tell my did it bother you to move around with the tail, your body moving back and forth to that upside down? The rudder is really sensitive. You just use tiptoes on it to beat you to death in there.
Yeah, yeah. It looked like it takeoff looked just a little swirly.
In flight, you move the rudder just a thousandths of an inch.
Oh, really? Yeah, in flight, huh?
Yes.
That's surprising. I didn't think it had that much sensitivity.
Yeah. The rudder is really sensitive.
Why shouldn't I?
The ailerons are just perfect. It stalls close to 100 miles an hour, but it doesn't go off on a wing, it just pitches over. It really stalls, it's just bam.
You know, remember Doolittle's tape, that tape with Doolittle, and how the R1 had that high-pitched whine? That's just, you're coming out, you can just hear that high-pitched whine whistle coming in. It just has that same sound.
That's an airplane.
That's an airplane.
Yeah. That's a pilot.
Huh. I'd like to go again. Can we get some more gas?
That's an airplane.
Just ahead, rare archive film of the original GB racers and a never-before-seen look at the making of the GB R2 replica. The GB legend begins in Springfield, Massachusetts, in the hangar of Granville Brothers Aircraft. In this converted dance hall, five brothers, Zanford, Thomas, Robert, Mark, and Ed, set out to build the fastest airplanes in America. The Granville Brothers' first all-out racing plane is the GB Model Z. Only one is built. It roars onto the scene in 1931, easily winning the Thompson Trophy race on its first try. Pilot Lowell Bales screams over the checkered flag at 236 miles an hour, the fastest speed ever set on the course, and almost 10 miles an hour faster than his nearest competitor. Later that year, the Z is fitted with a larger engine and tries for the land plane speed record in Detroit. Instead of capturing a great victory for the Granvilles, newsreel cameras report a terrible defeat. On its second pass, the plane heaves upwards. A wing snaps off, and the airplane crashes to the earth in a ball of flames. Pilot Lowell Bales, the national air racing hero, is killed. The beautiful black and yellow airplane, once nicknamed the Bumblebee, is now spoken of in hushed tones as the Killer Bee, and the haunting legend of the GB begins. The next spring, in the Granville Brothers hangar, work begins on two twin airplanes, the R1, designed for speed, and the R2, designed for distance. Both are completed in 9 months. This is the most famous of the Granville brothers' designs. The R-1 is entered in the 1932 Thompson Trophy race. The fastest airplane in the world is matched with the world's best pilot, Jimmy Doolittle, and together they make history. Doolittle becomes a human bullet at 253 miles an hour, winning the race, setting a course record and a world speed record all at once. The highest prize in air racing goes home with the Granvilles, again. Years later, in his autobiography, I Could Never Be So Lucky Again, Doolittle writes,
I flew the GB back to Springfield the next day. I landed it, taxied up to the line, gratefully got out and thanked the Granvilles. That airplane was the most dangerous airplane I have ever flown. I was asked many years later why I flew it if it was so dangerous. And the only answer I could think of was because it was the fastest airplane in the world at the time.
Doolittle's victory in 1932 is the last triumph for the Granvilles. In 1933, the R-1 crashes on takeoff during the Bendix Trophy race, killing pilot Russell Boardman. Later that same year, a GB Model Y crashes during the Phillips Trophy race, killing pilot Florence Klingensmith. In 1935, a hybrid R-1-R-2 crashes on takeoff during the Bendix Trophy race, killing pilot Cecil Allen. The string of tragedies is more than the brothers can bear. After just 5 years in the air racing spotlight, the Granville Brothers Aircraft Company is sold at a sheriff's sale, and the final nail is hammered into the flying coffin. The GB's reputation as a killer airplane weaves itself through conversations for 60 years until two airshow pilots begin to wonder if it's true.
We were weathered in Rapid City, South Dakota, Del Mar and I, and we were just sitting around the motel room talking about different airplanes that we have admired. We got bringing up the GB, and most people talk about the GB like it's just a death trap type of thing, and nobody'd ever want to build it. And then all of a sudden, you know, we went, well, you know, if there was a GB sitting out on the ramp, I'd go fly it. You know, like that's what Delmar said. And I said, yeah, I would too. I wouldn't be afraid to fly it. I'd want to fly it. And just kind of one thing led to another.
Construction of the GB R-2 replica begins at Wolf Aircraft in January 1991. Like the original, it is built by a team of five: Steve Wolf, Liz Wolf, Delmar Benjamin, Dwayne Trappin, and Jim McAllister.
One thing, there won't be a dozen of these out flying.
While the original drawings still exist,
last piece of fabric going on the fuselage right now.
The tarnish of a bad reputation keeps the Granville estate from releasing them to anyone building a flying replica.
We know it'll be as nice as they had their original.
Instead, this airplane will have to be built from a new set of plans, drawn from studying hundreds of photographs and talking with the man the Granvilles hired to design the original, Howell Pete Miller, still living in New England.
This guy was so nice, took us in to his home and just made us have a whole new goal in the project, and that was to build the airplane, prove that it flies, and then take it back and show Pete. Because here's a guy that had lived the last 60 years with stories progressively getting worse and worse and worse about the airplane, and everything printed and called them death traps, the flying barrel killer, and all this other stuff. Well, yeah, we're pretty well lined up.
The Miller-designed R-Series GBs are the first racers to spring from the mind of an aeronautical engineer and be tested in a wind tunnel.
Solid little wing.
This, and the lessons learned from the Model Z crash, combined to create an airplane generations ahead of its time.
So as you can see, the structure of this aircraft is a lot of steel, wood, and then fabric over top of the wood.
Airflow over the fuselage that Miller could only theorize is confirmed by computer simulation.
Last chance to look inside.
The airframe is designed to withstand 14 times the force of gravity at 450 miles an hour.
We're coming at you now.
The modified M6 airfoil will experience wing loading forces of 40 pounds per square foot, comparable to a Learjet.
This airplane is built like a plow. It was built by a bunch of farm boys, and it was built to go 300 miles an hour, which was as fast as anybody had gone in 1932. That was high tech, and it was built really overbuilt. Every part of the airplane is overbuilt. It was built really stiff because they were just getting into flutter problems then, and they didn't quite understand it. So stiffness is what they built in, and strength.
The aircraft's shape is inspired by the most aerodynamic body in nature, the raindrop, with just enough wing to get it in the air. Nearly every surface of the fuselage is a compound curve. Constructing a GB places high demands on the patience and skills of the builders.
We know the Granvilles probably ran into the same problems. You know, they were building the shape and everything, and they're probably sitting scratching their heads too. You know, back in 1932, going, God, we got to get this thing done. And
even with 3 to 4 people working pretty much full time since the first of the year, I really, someday I'll add the hours up, but I know it's gone over 5,000 hours now.
It is a project kept alive by dedication, just as the original all those years ago.
Well, I wonder if the Granville's ghost are keeping an eye on us doing this, you know? I would hope to think that this, if there was a way for them to know what was going on, that they would be really tickled that we're doing it, you know? And not, I think they would be, because I think they really had a real belief in their airplane and what it was capable of doing as much as we are. And they had so much bad luck with the airplane as far as just luck goes, not necessarily whether it was a good or bad airplane, but just a lot of misfortunate things that happened that was beyond their control.
The GBR2 replica is built aerodynamically identical to the original, right down to a remanufactured Pratt & Whitney radial engine.
The engine's capable of putting out a little over 500 horsepower, and the original GB had a racing Pratt & Whitney of 535 horsepower. This one's probably about 510, but it still will be plenty of power to power an airplane as light as a Volkswagen.
Hydraulic brakes and a movable tail wheel are the only compromises to modern runways. In all other respects, this is exactly like the R2 that rolled out of the Granville's hangar 6 decades ago.
Jim says that's the airplane we know and love so well.
It's like climbing into a time machine, because this model of aircraft hasn't flown since 1932, 1933. And it's just been a dream since then. And since I was just a small boy, I dreamed about this airplane. I thought it's the neatest airplane that was ever built, and I still do. I've got everything ready to go, I think.
Yeah.
Under this thing.
Right.
And then, let's go.
Okay.
Well, it is a little piece of the past. It's that thrill when you open 500 horsepower. Feels good.
Hey.
That made my eyeballs sweat.
We can almost say it's flown. I guess you did. You got it skipping there where you had it in the air for a second.
Yes, when I brought the tail down, it was flying. It was really light.
What were you thinking then?
I wanted to go flying.
The reputation that it had, I was aware of that simply because when Dell would talk to other people about what he was planning on doing, they'd say, oh, that killer airplane, or the big one that came up a lot was the Widowmaker. And I thought, oh boy, that's just what we need, you know. Here we have two teenage daughters and the Widowmaker airplane, he's going to fly now. So I wasn't too crazy about it just because of that reputation. But Delmore's reputation with me has always been substantial enough to know that he doesn't take chances. He's not that daredevil pilot that a lot of people think that he is, and he doesn't take chances with his life, let alone anybody else's.
And I think the spirit of the Granvilles is the spirit of the GB. This was an overwhelming job for us to build this airplane, to finance it and put the hours in to build it, just to persevere and get it done. There are a lot of GB projects in the world, but a lot of them will never be finished because it takes a great deal of perseverance. The Granvilles, they had that. They built two of these in 9 months during the Depression. So I think I understand more than anybody what those guys went through. I have the highest respects for them.
Up next, the R2's original designer sees the replica fly for the first time.
So it was very rewarding to me when Pete Miller came up. He kind of put his arm around me and said, you know, your airplane's much nicer than the original. And that really made me feel good.
July 1992, Benjamin and Wolf make good on their promise to show the GB R2 replica to the man who designed the original, 92-year-old Howell Pete Miller.
Hi!
How are you doing?
Good.
Good to see you here.
Wonderful.
Get a look at the airplane.
Sure do. It's wonderful. You're a wonderful guy.
Miller is the only surviving member of the team that built the most famous race plane in history.
Well, Pete, what do you think?
Well, I think your husband is a real man.
It's just an airplane.
It's been 60 years since he last saw a GB.
I left the exhaust stains on it so you'd know that it really flies.
And the last he saw of a GB was wreckage.
There it is.
What do you think of it, huh?
Wonderful.
Good.
Wonderful.
You would be the one to know.
Hey, we going to take that thing around? You can sit on my lap and I'll take it around.
A machine that stepped from Miller's imagination as a young engineer steps from the past to greet him as an old man. The time apart is forgotten, and familiarity comes rushing back.
Oh, my goodness. Look at that.
Go ahead and poke your head inside of there.
Oh!
You're not claustrophobic, I take it.
Say, that's wonderful. That is wonderful.
Did we do it right?
You certainly did. Congratulations.
Thank you.
The original GB racers lived for only a few years.
By golly, look at this.
Oh, for crying out loud.
Much that has been said about them comes from people who never saw the original aircraft. While much can be said about the replica, Benjamin decides to let the airplane speak for itself. Miller's wife, Dottie, steadies his balance as she shares his excitement.
Well, does that sound right?
True.
With the old individual exhaust sacks, you know, we had to get that right.
Miller has lived much of his life with a reputation for creating the flying coffin. This is the day that reputation ends.
Pete, this is a fulfillment of Delmar's dream to fly in front of you.
Oh!
Fly for you.
Oh, isn't that
That's
isn't
right.
That wonderful.
This is the main reason that he came out here.
QB7 Golf Bravo, the United Jet, we're just asking about you there. We're trying to fill him in. Runway 33, right traffic, clear for takeoff.
Oh, Pete, he's getting ready to go.
Yep.
Oh,
there he goes.
And he's got liftoff, Pete.
Yep.
Yeah.
Wonderful.
I feel bad that that airplane had the reputation that people gave it. Just all myth, you know. Delmar loves flying that airplane, Pete, and he said you did a good job of designing it.
Yeah, by golly.
That's wonderful. That just, you're telling Pete that is worth $1 million to Anna.
He's a wonderful guy. I wish I could do it.
Yeah.
Here he comes.
Oh, wow.
Pilot salutes engineer, and a killer reputation bows off the stage.
Jesus. Oh, wow!
Oh, don't fall over now.
Say, this has been wonderful, wasn't it?
It certainly was, Pete. And I'm so glad you saw it. Oh.
Delmar, this is Gladys Granville.
Glad to meet you.
Oh, I'm glad to meet you, too. What a proud moment, huh?
This is high Jones.
Gladys Granville Jones is the last surviving sister of the Granville brothers.
I wish my brothers could have lived to see this big day.
She remembers pushing the broom across the hangar floor where the original GBs were built, but never thought she would see this airplane fly again.
Well, there have been 2-3 replicas built, so I wasn't too surprised, but somehow this one I didn't expect they would. 7-Eleven, I didn't know was anyone to build one and fly one, because there have been so many horrible things said about him. Now he's proved that they're all right.
Doesn't that make you feel good?
Oh, it does. You can't imagine.
While Benjamin and Wolf admire the original R2 for what it was, Miller admires the replica for what it is, a modern creation of a classic design with exquisite detail and craftsmanship.
Yeah. That's off the original R2?
Yeah, that's the one that crashed at Bowles Airport in 33.
One thing Benjamin and Wolf miss on their replica is the color of the pinstriping. In black and white pictures, it looks black. Few people got close enough to the original to tell otherwise.
Do you notice the color of the pinstriping around it?
Yes.
It's blue.
Now you got to go and change it.
Witness the R2 replica break the land speed record set by the original. As we continue, GB history flies again.
Now you want a 7 or come 11? 7-11, coming out. Gentlemen, get your bets down early.
The numbers 7 and 11 on the sides of the GB racers are borrowed from the game of craps.
7, a winner, 7. Pay on a pass.
7 and 11 are wonderful numbers. About the time that the GB was flying originally, if anybody was in a crap game and they were screaming for 7, come 11.
The game is prophetic for two little airplanes that carry the numbers into the sky.
After you get a point established, say 7's not so good. You don't want a 7 to roll. You don't want a 7 to roll after a point's established. After you got a point, 7 kill you.
Conquering this airplane is the closest analogy is I learned how to ride a unicycle when I was a kid. And it looks very easy when you see somebody riding a unicycle around. But to learn how the learning experience is excruciating to learn to ride a, you get hurt. And climbing the GB, it's, other airplanes are bicycles, and this is a unicycle. There's a lot of things to learn in a short period of time, and I feel very fortunate that we got to this point without breaking up the airplane, because it could happen very easily.
The GB R2 replica stands just over 8 feet tall. Modern jets dwarf its size and cruise at twice its top speed. But in the golden age of air racing, nothing flies faster nor attracts more attention than the GB racers. The R1 with pilot Jimmy Doolittle sets a closed course speed record in 1932 that holds for 4 years. 60 years later, Benjamin breaks that record in the R2 replica at the Reno Air Races. The old record is broken by 4 miles an hour, proving this shady lady of the skies can still race.
Oh, it's magnificent. Wonderful to see 60 years of myth demolished by one brilliant exhibition. Really remarkable. What an airplane, what a pilot. And I know the Granville brothers must be looking down with absolute joy, and I know that Howell Miller, that grand old gentleman, is so happy about this. You know, you just wouldn't think a pilot would have the courage to do it, given the fact that for 60 years everybody said it was a killer. And then to fly it like this, he's made converts out of everybody that sees it.
The Reno Air Races give us a glimpse of what air racing was like in its golden age, when 60,000 people would gather to watch this Indianapolis in the air. Tucked away in the back of the Crawford Museum in Cleveland, Ohio, sits the only remaining original airplane from the golden age of air racing, a 1932 Waddell Williams. This plane raced against the GB in 1932. Now fully restored, this classic racer gives us a glimpse of how the original airplanes looked and sounded.
Fire!
The inertia starter is mostly silent now. Its whir lost to the ages. If this airplane could talk, one wonders what it would say.
Take me out and fly me. This aircraft was built to fly and race, and we're glad to have it on exhibit, but it's really out of context here. It should be in the sky.
The R2 replica is at home in the sky, but someday it too will likely retire to a museum. Until then, it flies to tell us what it was designed to do, and let us judge for ourselves its killer reputation.
I don't know if it's fair or unfair. It doesn't have any impact on me. It's that 99% of the people that sit and watch their TV. They're really not interested in truth. Truth is a scarce commodity, and they're more interested in something that's sensational. I think a lot of the people come not just to see the GB fly, but to see it crash. And that's okay. All I have to do is avoid crashing it. And I think for me, that's not a hard job.
The GB is no longer the fastest airplane in America. Today, that honor belongs to the Strega. 60 years and 200 miles an hour separate the two aircraft.
Is this the flyer of that?
Oh, it's
Bill DeStephanie.
Me.
Glad to meet you. Delmar.
Delmar Benjamin.
Pleased to meet you.
Shelby, Montana.
You do a heck of a job with that airplane.
Thank you.
Sure does. Yeah.
You likewise.
But speed is only one adjective to describe these machines.
Well, is it pretty neat to fly?
It is. It's really fun to fly and not so fun to land.
Yeah.
Compromises must be made.
Yeah. Well, I think the pedals need to come a little closer for me, but... heck of a deal.
This guy'd be a piece of cake compared to a GB. I can see what's in front of me already.
Still to come, join the audience as the GB steals the show.
I've seen Delmar drive, and that scares me a whole lot worse than to see him fly that GB.
The Benjamins farm 2,500 acres of wheat and barley in Montana. From this soil, they raise two daughters and the dream of flying a GB. Being a farmer, like being a pilot, is more than what you do. It's what you are. Few choose to accept the risks of either, but Benjamin accepts the risks of both.
Because I'm in control of the risk, only me. I don't have to depend on anybody else. As in farming, it's my risk. I take the risk, which I decide which crops to sell. And I'm at the mercy of the weather in farming and in the airshow business. But basically, it's me that I have to depend on. And I think I'm a good risk. And my knowledge of the airplane, I think it's basically sound. It's an investment in myself. The satisfaction derived, even if it's a failure. If I'd have crashed it on the first flight, it wouldn't have been that great a loss for me. I got so far down the road. I guess I'm still in shock somewhat from, I wasn't sure that I could fly the airplane. And I got by that, and I'm just kind of getting over sliding into the reality that maybe I can fly this airplane.
Now this is my most favorite maneuver that he does, the knife edge. And look how he doesn't lose any altitude, doesn't gain any altitude. Delmar calls it his happy little airplane, and he's a happy boy when he's flying it.
Benjamin has more than 150 hours in the GB, more than any other pilot. Many of those hours are spent crisscrossing the country to air shows. More than an icon of speed, the GB is a testament to what can be accomplished through perseverance.
I don't really think that our message to people out there is any different than the Olympic athletes. You know, if they've wanted to get there bad enough, they've gotten there, and that's the same with us. It's emotion that's in it. That's why Delmar's a farmer, is because it's in his blood, and that's why he has the GB, is because it's in his blood, and that's why he flies it. Look at this nice inverted flight doing a slow roll across the sky. It almost feels like I'm going to get tears in my eyes even as I speak, because I'm so proud of what Delmer has done. I honestly have never met another pilot that I feel as capable as Delmer is of flying the GB. As I stand on the announcer stand and look out at him and see him flying up there, I'm really proud of him. He knows what he's doing and he does a doggone good job.
What a day for an air show. Marvelous to live here in the beautiful Pacific Northwest. Here we go, ladies and gentlemen. Del Benjamin in the GB R2 Racer 1932 is living again. That airplane is not the pilot killer. That history has it tagged.
I learned early on that you keep the speed up. And the slower the airplane goes, the more concentration you need. On landing, I discovered on my third flight that it has aileron reversal. And I scuffed a wingtip, and it was just due to reactions that stopped that snap roll and got the airplane under control. There was no time to think about it. It happens in a flash, like an explosion. That's where the airplanes went. That's what destroyed them, is they were flying the airplane too slow.
Benjamin could fix the wingtip he scuffed that day, but it remains to remind him how easily he could become not just a man who flies a GB, but a man who dies in one. The killer bee still has its stinger, and its reputation is not a myth.
No, it's deserved reputation. All the stories about the airplane were basically true. It is unstable. It's unstable in pitch and yaw. That doesn't intimidate me. It just needs a pilot. As long as you pay attention and fly it, it's not a problem.
It's flying knife edge. It's on the side of the fuselage. The wings are not lifting it at all. The airplane is going the full length of the field. Knife edge. Push, Dale. Push. Don't let it get away.
Somewhere in the crowd are aviation pioneers yet to be. No longer limited by propellers and pistons, they'll use rockets and jets to go places we can only imagine. If a kid looks up to admire the GB, Benjamin tells him it all starts with a dream.
I think the best thing is to get down on one knee and talk to this kid, and so he can see that I'm not that tall, and he could be there if he wants to. I think there's very few people that couldn't build and fly a GB if they just persevered along that path.
On the runway, you folks on the flight line will see the people have lifted two 18-foot poles in the air. Now remember, he cannot see forward, so what he's going to do, he's going to turn it upside down. Can he get low enough? He's maneuvering the airplane. Oh, get your pictures, folks. I don't have time. And what's he going to do? And he got the ribbon. He got it right through, and he's not even in a hurry to get right side up.
The Granvilles set out to build the fastest airplanes in America, and they did. Benjamin set out to prove he could fly a GB, and he does. Both pilot and airplane establish a new reputation every time history flies again.
There's not really an end to my journey. My life is a journey. I never gave that much thought till I climbed this mountain. I will always be climbing mountains.
The theory was in those days to build a flying engine as closely as possible to get the most horsepower on the smallest wing.
It was a minimum airplane. I mean, minimum control area, minimum stabilizer area, minimum wing area, everything you do, because it was built for one thing, and that was just to go fast.
It's fun to fly, but it's a challenge. You need to pay attention every minute. You can't relax. The landings are basically not fun.
It's hard to believe that anybody would have the skills to create an airplane that beautiful again from the past, and then have the brains and the bravery to fly it in such a spectacular manner. I thought it was remarkable.
Delmar says it best, stability spells boring.
VHS videotape copies of GB History Flies Again are available from Deltana Air Shows, Deltana Drive, Shelby, Montana, 59474, or call the Deltana Air Shows 24-hour order line, 1-800-342-4272. Each tape costs $39.95 plus $5 for shipping and handling. Please allow 6 weeks for delivery.
Looks like he ran out of money right behind the cockpit. Oh, the door's open! Oh, Snoopy! Oh, for goodness sakes. Well, that's the way it goes.
This is the air show business. Beats driving that tractor.